I don't need to repeat them, do I? We know what they are. So, we heard we got to wake up. We've got to rise up. We've got to pray up. We've got to speak up. We've got to mount up. And the last one we just heard was look up, because our redemption draws nigh. So I think that I'm going to talk a little bit about that redemption drawing nigh in dress up.
All right.
To Pastor Monty, to Bishop, to all of you, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. By the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, these thoughts came to mind as I was preparing this message on dress up. When we were little, our parents found numerous reasons and occasions to put us on the cutest outfits that they could find, whether it was for to go out to a cookout or birthday parties, on vacations, or others for to church. And so much so that as we got older, we did it for our children and we do it for ourselves. Mm-hmm. Now, weddings have long since been one of the occasions for extravagance. Young women live out their fantasy of being princess for a day. Elegant gowns, eloquent hairstyles, attendance in color-coordinated dresses, flowers, an abundance of food, and lots of celebrating with friends and families. Imagine with me, if you will, a royal wedding. It would then take extravagance to another level, a level that common folks would never see, unless, picture it, 1981, when many of us got to peek at Prince George and Princess Diana's wedding as it was broadcast worldwide, or even more recent, Prince Harry and Meghan Markle.
All right.
I said that to say this, another royal wedding, our redemption drawing now, is in the planning stages, and it will be more elaborate than any other. However, in this wedding, the most important person will be the groom, Christ himself, and we've got, and we are the church, we're going to be his bride. Mm-hmm. John's revelation says that the bride will make herself ready in chapter 19 and verse 7. And our wedding gown will be our righteous and just acts in verse 8. Even though earthly marriages last for a lifetime, every bride works hard to make her wedding perfect.
All right.
How much more, as the bride of Christ, should we be doing to prepare ourselves for a marriage that will last for an eternity?
Amen.
Which is why today, for a few more minutes, I want to speak on the topic, dress up.
Dress up.
I would like to use four biblical illustrations that suggest there might be a need for God's people to dress up. In the book of Exodus, we find a story where Yahweh met Moses on Mount Sinai to give him some laws and instructions on his expectations of this people and the building of his tabernacle. Mm-hmm. He tells Moses in Exodus 25 and 8, let them make me a sanctuary where I may dwell among them. He went on to tell Moses, I want you as high priest to sanctify them and instruct them before they come before me to hear from me, to wash their garments. If you will, dress up for my word.
All right.
Why would this God tell the people to wash their garments? In Exodus 19, verses 10 through 25, the context of the passage is such that the children of Israel had been just released by Pharaoh because of 9 major plagues that was sent by Yahweh to aid in this persuasion. They were people wandering in the wilderness as an amalgamation, a mixed nation, marginalized, disenfranchised, separated from their gods and their presumed purpose. A people who had no land and no real possessions, but who had the garments on their backs. So there was a stench of slavery and bondage with the residue of idol worship from other customs, cultures, and traditions all over them. And if the truth be told, God is speaking to some of us saying, sanctify yourself.
Well,
wash your garments, because we have the stench of slavery and bondage to drugs and alcohol, sexual immorality, gossiping, lying, abuse, and misuse all over us. And we need to sanctify ourselves. We need to wash our garments. Dress up, because God says, I have a word for you. I want to dwell in you. I want to bring you to a promised destiny and purpose. Verse 14, and Moses went down from the mount unto the people and sanctified the people, and they washed their garments. Dress up for the word. I believe another such occasion where there might be a need for God's people to dress up is when we come into his presence. You see, the presence of an almighty God ought to awe and inspire, intrigue, and spark the desire to praise and to worship. So when we come to meet with the Lord at the tent of meeting, mm-hmm. I believe God is saying, dress up for
dress
worship.
Up. Amen.
Our worship is directly linked to our understanding of the Old Testament temple worship. The Aaronic priests, we've heard it, entered daily into the tabernacle of Moses and later the temple of Solomon, moving through the courts to minister to the Lord in the holy place. One time a year, the high priest went into the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was kept representing the presence of God. Know this, that they couldn't just go in any kind of way. There were garments that the priests had to put on, and they had to cleanse themselves before they went in. The outer court, there was a laver and a basin where the priests washed their hands, and the brazen altar where they made a sacrifice before entering into the inner court, or the holy place where the tabernacle, where the table of showbread represented how Yahweh had been their provider. The golden lampstand, he had directed their path. The altar of incense as they prayed, representing a sweet aroma in the nostrils of God. Then there was the veil, a constant reminder of man's limited access to Yahweh. And that's why they tied a rope with a bell around the ankle of the high priest, because if he wasn't right when he went in, he fell dead in the presence of God. I believe God is saying to us today, as the psalmist penned, pull off the spirit of heaviness and put on the garments of praise. Dress up for worship. I'm here to remind us today that praise and worship is not a song, but a lifestyle. Some of us today are guilty of deducing a lifestyle of worship to acts of worship. We meet on Sunday morning, we read a scripture, pray a prayer, sing a few songs, and get our praise on, and we say we worship God. But I come to tell you that herein is the essence of our worship. Psalms 100, verse 4. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. This suggests that our worship must be intentional. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. And as you dress up for worship, pass by the laver and be regenerated by the washing of the word. Who can come before God except he that have clean hands and a pure heart? There's a brazen altar where the priest made the sacrifice to Yahweh. Our brazen altar, he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. As you move into the inner court, take a good look at the table of showbread. For my God said he will supply all our need according to his riches in glory. And don't forget about the lampstand. He said that he would be a lamp to our feet and a light on our pathway. At the altar of incense, let your prayers be a sweet-smelling savor in God's nostrils. Pray up. When I think about the veil, when Jesus died on the cross, the veil was rent from the top to the bottom. No more limited access, but full, unobstructed access to the mercy seat of God. Enter boldly before the throne of grace that we might obtain mercy in a needed time. Praise is the acknowledgement of what God has done, but the pinnacle of praise is to acknowledge who God is. Dress up for worship. Then I want to leave you with this thought. There are going to be times when it looks like everything and everybody is messing with you. God is saying that's when you might want to dress up for war. Ephesians 6 and 10, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Your fight is not with flesh and blood, but principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this age, spiritual wickedness in high places. Dress up for war. Put on the whole armor of God so that you'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We've got the helmet of salvation. It covers our mind. And he said he would keep us in perfect peace if we keep our minds stayed on him. Put on the breastplate of righteousness, and it's covering our heart. For out of the heart flows the issues of life. We got the shield of faith to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. I used to say every time that enemy would come at me, you know, Lucifer sang. He did the music in heaven. He ministered to God's throne. And I was like, man, every time he threw a dart at me, I got one of those. I got that. I got some music notes. I'll throw them right back. Have your loins girded about with truth. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. That's the word. Praying always. Weapons of this warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds and casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And what does the knowledge of God say? We heard it today. We are more than conquerors through the blood of Jesus. And no weapon formed against us is going to prosper. And greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Dress up for the word. Dress up for worship. Dress up for war.